Everybody. So I've had several people ask me what happened, what my story was, if I'd be willing to share it. So I'm just going to give you a quick rundown of kind of what happened to me. In order to understand it, I have to back date to October 11th of 2019. I went in for migraine surgery. The doctor was going to decompress and remove some damaged nerves. Surgery went great. Doctor said everything looked well. I went home. On the 14th, I went back. Surgeon said everything looked great. Went home. On the 17th, I went back. Surgeon said everything looked great. I went home. And then comes the morning of October 22nd, 2019. That is the day my life changed forever. I woke up that morning. And I was sick. Oh, I was so sick. I was vomiting and diarrhea. My head was pounding. Nothing helped me. I went and talked to my mom. And we agreed that I was probably picked up a stomach bug somewhere along the way. So I went and laid back down. A couple hours went by and I was just getting worse and worse. And I called my doctor, and he said, go to your local emergency room and have them give you some funny fluids. You're probably dehydrated. So I said, okay. And he thought, too, that was probably just a stomach bug. So I went to the hospital. Well, let me back up. We got dressed, walked outside, got in the truck, drove to the hospital. These things I remember. Once we got inside that hospital, I do not remember anything. Nothing. Total blackout. My mother said the doctor said that there was some pus on one of the incisions. They called my doctor. My doctor said get her up to UT Southwestern in Dallas ASAP. I was put on care flight. Again, do not remember it. Don't remember the flight or anything. While I was on the flight, apparently I ripped out my central line. As you can see the scar on my neck and then the scars over here, but they had to replace it. Again, don't remember that. By the time I arrived to UT Southwestern, my blood pressure was 74 over 22. I was dying, and I was dying fast. They told my mom I had a 1% chance of surviving, and that she needed to call Chad and get him and the twins up there. So she called Chad. Chad and the twins came up there. When upon their arrival, they were met at the elevator by the doctor. And the doctor said, 1% chance of surviving, that I'm going to die. And he needs to maybe go ahead and make arrangements. So Chad and the twins came in and they talked to me. They saw me, held my hand and cried. Again, I don't remember any of this. Chad went ahead and called Wayne Bro's funeral home and put them on standby. Extended family and friends started coming up to the hospital and coming in and saying their goodbyes. We had the principal from the twin school show up, their athletic director show up, just to be there for moral support. So again, everybody was just kind of sitting around crying and waiting for me to die. A different team of doctors came in. Someone from the CDC, an infectious disease. They had advised that I needed to be placed in a roto bed. A roto bed is a bed that rotates back and forth. However, UT Southwestern didn't have a roto bed. So they had to find one, and they found one in Illinois. So they had it sent from Illinois to Dallas, and they placed me in it face down, and rotated me back and forth, and this was to help keep fluid off of my lungs. Again, I don't remember. I've seen pictures of me in it. I've seen video, but I don't remember any of it. After a few days in the roto bed, they took me out. and I was on a regular bed. I was still on life support. They were doing everything they could to stabilize me. My blood pressure wasn't stabilizing or anything. They still were unsure as to what really was going on. Parkland Hospital actually called my doctor and said, look, we have a new medication that you can try on her. It's still in the trial phases. It hasn't really been given out to the public. So they tried it on me. And the next day I started improving. And I improved a little bit more. But I was still on life support. And then on November 2nd, I remember this little voice saying, Mom, open your eyes. And then it got a little bit louder and it said, Mom, open your eyes. So I opened my eyes. And that little voice was my daughter. Doctors, nurses, family, friends, everybody was in shock that I opened my eyes. I, however, was in panic mode. I didn't know where I was, what was going on, what was happening. All I knew was I had a tube down my throat. I had tubes in my nose. I had IVs in my arms. I had IVs in my legs. I didn't know what was going on, so I panicked. But I woke up. The doctors were shocked. And I remember them telling me multiple times, nobody will ever believe this story, that you woke up. They ended up diagnosing me with toxic shock syndrome caused by strep. What happened was there was a stitch on the back of my head that got strep on it, and it entered my body and it started shutting my organs down. My kidneys failed me. I was on dialysis 3 times a week for several weeks. While I was in there, I noticed that my fingers and my toes were black. I asked the doctors why my fingers and toes were black. Were they going to turn back to pink? And they told me my fingers and my toes were dead. And when I asked them why, they said that with all the medications and the rotating bed and everything, that the blood flow was pulled from my extremities and pushed to my major organs to keep me alive. And I asked them if I'm going to regain blood flow, and they said more than likely not, but we're hoping. So they would come in every couple days and they would take needles and they would poke me in the palms of my hands or in my feet, just to see if we had blood. Unfortunately, there was no blood flow. So, on December 16th, the 2019, I went in, and I had a quadruple amputation. I lost both hands and both feet. Surgery went well then. A little hard waking up and realizing that you have no hands and you have no feet and your world just got turned upside down. You don't know what you're going to do. You don't know anything. You're pretty much at a loss. But you try to keep your spirits up and you try to be happy. The next step after that, the doctor said, was rehab. So the amputation was on the 16th. 10 days later, on December 26th, the day after Christmas, I was transferred to rehab. And while in rehab, they did pretty much everything they could to piss me off and make me mad, because it was hard. And I didn't want to do it, because it hurt. They had me standing on temporary prosthetics. It hurt. I cried. They had me learning how to dress myself, try to feed myself, and then I'd get frustrated and get mad and cry because I couldn't do it. It was hard. They measured me for an automatic wheelchair. So I do have one of those at home now. But rehab did their job. I gotta give it to them. They did it. They pissed me off. They made me cry. They hurt me. But they did their job and they did it well. I was discharged from rehab on January 15th and I was sent home. Upon arriving home, Chad had built me a ramp to get into the house. He built me a new walk-in shower. All I gotta do is drive my wheelchair into the shower and somebody's just got to remove it, the wheelchair. Now that I'm home, I'm able to brush my own teeth. I can dress myself. I can go to the bathroom alone. That's a big one. Little tiny things I can do. I can transfer from the chair to the bed, the chair to the couch, the chair to the car. Just little things like that. I still have trouble feeding myself, but I'll get there. I do have a temporary prosthetic for both legs at home. They're not my permanent ones, but I can use them and I can stand, and I can't walk yet, but I'll get there. I'll get there. I'll learn to walk again. I'm currently still waiting on approval for my prosthetics for my hands. One of the hands on my right arm is going to be a robotic hand. So all five fingers will function like a normal hand. And on my left hand, the prosthetic is going to be one that just opens and closes. This will give me control back over my life, and I'll be able to do some of the things that I was able to do before I lost my hand. That's pretty much it in a nutshell. I pray deeply that nobody ever gets toxic shock syndrome. They say 6 out of every 100,000 will survive. And I thank God each day that I'm one of those 6.